Welcome, everybody. My name is Mark Doolin, and this is my podcast, Mark's Mouthpiece. For all previous interviews, you can find them all on YouTube. You can find over 60 interviews with some of the world's greatest brass players. And while you're there, if you would please like and subscribe to my videos. The podcasts today are sponsored by Studio 259 Productions, where you can find all of the Vincent Chickowitz materials, the original three books, as well as some new publications by Hal Leonard for young students. And we even have them for trombones because we all know that there's not a trombone player that doesn't need to work on their fundamentals. And also, I'd like to thank Guard Bags for helping sponsor these podcasts as well. For any more information about me, you can go to my website. And also, if you're so inclined, please look on Patreon. And you'll find me on there, and please feel free to make a small donation to help keep these podcasts going. So without any further ado, I'd like to welcome my guest today, Omar Tomasoni, principal trumpet of the Royal Concertgebouw Orchestra in Amsterdam. Omar, it's great to have you on. Thank you so much for doing this.
Thank you very much. Nice to see you again after the pandemic times.
I know. I think the RCO kind of helped people get through the pandemic with some of the interviews that you and Martin did, and of course the concerts where everybody was spread out so far, but they were broadcast in such a way that I think brought a lot of people together. So Omar, I know, especially in the States, we all know who you are, but I don't know if we all know, we just know your background. We just know this. That guy plays in the Concertgebouw and he sounds great all the time. Could you talk about your beginnings in Brescia and where you grew up? I mean, who was your first teacher? Was there music around your house? Was your family musical? Any other background like that?
Well, I started very young. I was 5 years old when I started. And I started because my father was a trumpet player. And my mother, a clarinet player, and they were playing in the band, in the wind band in the village. I'm from a very small village in Brescia. It's around 25 kilometers from the big city. And I started because I wanted to be with my parents, basically. They were on Sunday playing. And it was a moment that the family could join and could enjoy, actually, all together. So I started. When I was 6 years old. After 1 year, my mother saw that I was very much passionate about it. I was practicing without them pushing me, etc. So they decided to find a professional teacher for me. Mm-hmm. And I was lucky enough that the teacher that actually brought me until my diploma, so which my graduation, you know, in the conservatory in Brescia, was the teacher that accepted to teach me when I was very small, very young. And he did it after many, many phone calls from my mother, because, of course, the first time he said that I was too young, but she kept insisting, you know, she kept asking him, Please, just give him a chance to play once for you. And then if he's too young, if he's too small, you will tell us. And luckily, the first meeting went well. So he was quite an enthusiast. And then his name, the teacher's name, is Sergio Malacarne, which was a principal trumpet in Arena di Verona. So he accepted to give me lessons. Mm-hmm. And then since 7 years old until when I graduated, which was 17. So for 10 years, he followed me. Basically, he has been my main teacher and my main guide, who is still today I call, and we are still big friends. We go to ski together. We met just last week. Wow. Which he came to see a concert, which I played. I conduct actually in Lugano this brass project. So he was there with my parents. And I'm very grateful to him. So this was the beginning. So I studied in Brescia. After these private lessons, I went to Brescia, so to the conservatory, which Sergio was teaching there. Mm-hmm. I finished the school. I went 2 years in Switzerland with Gabriele Cassone. Mm-hmm. which in that time he was teaching in Lausanne, in Lausanne. I followed him for 2 years. And then I went to, well, I followed a bit, I entered this European Union of Orchestra. So there were some teachers from London Symphony, etc. So I of course got some lessons from them.
Mm-hmm.
And in the meantime, I had the luck to meet Max Sommerhalder, because he was also giving, he was actually teaching to brass quintet of the Italian part of the Youth European Union of Orchestra. I met him, and then luckily enough, I also met Giuliano, which we decided to do the quintet. And yeah, then everything, like the real professional stuff started really. And I won Firenze, the position Imaggio Musicale Fiorentino, when I was 18 years old.
Yeah.
After that, I saved some money from the study, and I had the chance to come to New York to have private lessons from Pensarella, mainly from Pensarella, but also some lessons from Phil Smith.
Mm-hmm.
And then, yeah, this was actually, this is a bit the quick resume of my studying. Of course, I don't have to forget one big name, which was very important for me, which is Pippo Baudanza, one of the greatest Italian legends, ex-principal trumpet. Now is unfortunately is not with us anymore, but he was a principal trumpet of Teatro La Scala for 30 years.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the most beautiful trumpet sounds that I can still remember. And I met him when I was 9 years old, because he was a big friend of Sergio, from my teacher. And my, mm-hmm. my so Sergio also studied with him. So we had the opportunity to organize master classes with him. And I met him very, very young. And I followed him also for a few years. And this was also very inspiring. So that's a bit the resume of my...
The background.
Yes.
So what was the, what materials were you working on with your first teacher? I believe it was some Louis Davidson materials. Is that what?
Yes, actually, this was my first book, actually. The first book that he gave me was this Davidson. Mm-hmm. Which I still have the first version of it, and it's funny to see the written metronomes indication on it, and also he simplified some exercises for me because I was small, so some things were a bit complicated, but well, it's beautiful to see that actually still today is, I think, is one of my favorite books to warm up and to work with, yeah. You know, in the basics.
Yeah, it's such a it's, the trumpet world is so small. I played at Louis Davidson's funeral, actually.
Oh, really?
As a student, yeah. And you know, of course, he, and we'll talk about your recording later, but of course, he was so important to Louis, to Timothy Dachschitzer, which obviously is a lot of influence on your latest recording that we'll talk about.
But, definitely.
Yeah. Wow. So what other sound models were you listening to when you were growing up? I mean, obviously, I'm sure Maurice André and Holcon and people like that. What kind of players were you checking out when you were a young student?
Yeah, I remember, you know, my parents are from, I mean, they were playing, but they're actually just for hobby. So they didn't have a musical background. So we just got, I remember, I just got one cassette, which was this, you know, mm-hmm. when I was seven. And this was from Maurice André. It was a Maurice André cassette, and I consumed it. You know,
yeah.
I had this stereo that was going, you know, when the cassette was finishing in one side, it was going back automatically. And it was doing this for 24 hours. I remember I was putting, in that time I was sleeping in the same room with my sister, which she became a singer. Now she's a professional singer, mezzo soprano. But I remember we were sleeping always with the cassette of Maurice Andrain. So it was going like the A side was going, and then the B side was coming back, and the whole night like this, you know. Well, and I have to say this was until this cassette at the end, it was not sounding anymore because there was no sound. It was consumed. Like there was no track there anymore. So, this was the first really like the first player, the first person, the first musician that really was really following. And then, of course, after Doug Schitzer, definitely, of course. And the greatest after, of course, Wynton Marsalis, when he was still doing this classic thing. And then after with the jazz side, of course, etc. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, Okan, Reinhold, Giuliano, Max. And then, of course, you start to know people, and then you just go through things. But I remember I bought all the recordings, all the CDs from the Canadian brass, because when I was studying, there was no internet yet. So I'm probably one of the last that really had to go into a shop.
Oh, and, me too.
Look for the recordings. And I remember myself, the first time I was going to Japan, this was the thing I was doing all the time when I had the free time, because in Japan you could find recordings that in Italy were not there. Mm-hmm. So you could not find the same CDs or same recordings and stuff that you could find in Japan. Japan, they had everything, like everything was there.
Yeah.
And I remember myself going there and buying like all the CDs from Canadian brass, all the CDs from German brass, everything. Like so it was beautiful. And
and you probably listened to it more than you would have if it was just on the internet, right? Because you had to buy it and you had to find it, and it was like a treasure in that
man way. I listened. This is something I said to my students a few weeks ago. I said, do you actually listen really? Because we were doing something that was in my recordings. And then I said, what do I do in that bar? And then they didn't really know, like, do I play legato there or not? And they said, I don't remember. I said, man, if you would have listened carefully, you would really remember. And I remember myself listening one CD for weeks. Like really not listening is not just drinking a beer and putting on the background something, you know.
Yeah.
Listening is really sitting and listen details, listen really like going really deep, you know, like listen carefully, you know.
Yeah. Over and over, right?
Yes. Definitely. Yes. Yes.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I guess we're lucky that we didn't have the internet for probably many, many reasons. So, yeah, talk about your first position in Florence or Firenze. And Zubin Mehta is your first music director. Do you remember the audition and what was that like when Mehta congratulated you about winning the position?
Well, yes, this is a funny story because I did three auditions, but I never really won. So I was always in final alone, but he never gave me the position really. So I never won the audition there. And after 4 years, I was there and there was no, like, it was a position free. They just gave me a contract because I had the rights to play there. But officially, I never won that position, you know. And I remember the first time when I was 18 and a half, and I was alone playing in front of the jury, and Zubin Mehta was there listening. And I remember his comment in the end, which was quite funny. He said, "You play fantastic, but you sound a bit like a mariachi."
Oh, wow.
So, which for me was... I mean, it was funny, but also like I thought it like was a compliment because I mean I was actually a big fan of mariachi and I was a huge fan of all this kind of music, etc. And yeah, I didn't know how to take that what he said. Like, should I get offended? Should I be happy? And stuff. I don't know. But and then I did this audition for 3 times, multiple for 3 times alone. And at the end, they gave me a contract. And funny enough, after 6 months, I resigned because I won in Santa Cecilia, So this was a bit, yeah, it was a bit, yeah, it was a bit weird. But and of course, when he mentioned the mariachi, I immediately thought about Rafael Mendes,
Of
which
course.
became one of my big hero, when I was listening to Rafael Mendes things, I was like, oh, man. So I was like, well, if I sound like that, it's not too bad, I wish, I wish, So I was like, well, thank you. Well, this means I played quite good, But maybe it was not, it didn't mean like that,
Maybe, yeah, maybe he wasn't talking about the technique as much as he was the vibrato or something, maybe. Who knows? But
Maybe.
yeah. And then after that, you were in St. Cecilia for a bit of time before coming in the Concertgebouw. Can you talk about the audition for St. Cecilia? Do you remember much about
Yes,
that?
I remember Santa Cecilia because for the first time I played the final round with the orchestra. So it was a totally different audition. I have to say, really interesting concept, which I definitely would suggest to any orchestra to do it. So the final round was with the orchestra and with a conductor. So you were really doing the job you were supposed to audition for. So I remember I played with the orchestra, Mahler 5, Pictures, Don Pasquale, Petrushka, like all the biggest stuff, but in the orchestra, and the conductor could, of course, ask you anything like faster, slower, more staccato, more vibrato, whatever, and you had to react, of course, on what was around with the people around you, so with the musician around you, with your colleagues. And I have to say, this is very interesting concept, very, very, very interesting to do. And things were very clear immediately because you can hear immediately if somebody can fit that orchestra, if the sound is right for the hall, if the sound is right for that group. And it was a fantastic experience, I have to say. Interesting.
Interesting experience. And then, of course, came the biggest job, the Royal Concertgebouw position. And at that time, the music director would have been Marius Janssens, of course. What do you remember about that audition? I mean, I know you had probably subbed with them at some point, I believe, before the audition. Is that right? You had
I
played as
did
an
two
extra?
weeks before. I did only,
Two
I
weeks.
was guest for 2 weeks.
And do you remember your preparation for that audition? I mean, I'm sure it was a huge list.
Yes, I
And
remember.
what is the, versus Germany where it's a rotary B flat playing the Haydn in Concertgebouw, what is the first thing that you're going to play? Is it Tomasi and Haydn? Is that the solos for that audition?
I did 2 rounds. The semi-final was Haydn, the first movement, and then like 10 orchestra excerpts. And then if you pass, so this was blind with card, so they could not see the candidates. And the final was Tomasi, first movement with the cadenza, of course, and then orchestra excerpts. So this was the audition. No, the preparation was, it was quite intense, of course. And I remember the last month I was playing, I was lucky enough that I had this friend and a colleague in Santa Cecilia, which I trusted him very much. It was, he is actually Antonio Ruggeri. He was my second trumpet, and he used to be a principal trumpet for many, many years in Rome. And I consider him an extraordinary musician. So he was so kind that every day he was spending more than an hour with me every, like, the last month. So every day for 3, 3 and a half, 4 weeks, listening to me. So I was playing for him at least, 1 hour, 1 hour, 1 and a half hour every day. The whole program, going through Tomasi, going through many things, going through everything. And I remember I was struggling with Tomasi. Somehow I was getting very tired. Tomasi was kind of, it was not the easiest thing for me. It was like after the first page, first and a half page, I was really tired, And I remember him telling me this, which really changed everything, He said, "Man, you think it Tomasi too technically, you only think about technique, but you don't think about the music, Until you will not think about music, you will get definitely tired, And then, this was really a switch for me. Like, I started to actually think it as a music piece instead of virtuosistic stuff. And the day after, it was okay. It was funny enough, but sometimes you need just a few words, and
And that does it. So let's talk about the Concertgebouw a bit. Can you describe for people who have never sat in your seat, which is most people, what are the acoustics of the hall like, especially as a trumpet player? What do you get back from the hall? What do you have to give to the hall that a lot of other places is different?
I mean, the Concertgebouw, of course, is considered one of the most beautiful acoustic, and it is true. To listen is fantastic, and to play it is also, I have to say, the sound that comes back to you. I mean, you don't really get back something, but what you hear around you is always this warmth in the sound, which is nice. But it's never soft enough, which for us is a bit, it's not very easy. And the thing is, like, when you are playing, so when you are sitting in the orchestra, it's very difficult to listen, to hear actually your colleagues around. So for the ensemble, for the timing, is not the most easy acoustic, I have to say. And you need to get used a bit, of course. And but when you go to listen, it's really special, like everything blend. And the sound is really warm. And what I had to work myself, like personally, to match the whole is in the articulation, so that the articulation is very defined, because it's a bit, I mean, I don't want to say it's boomy, but it's a bit generous. So if you're not defined in your articulation, it can be a bit you can lose details easily.
Can you talk a little bit, because you and I have spoken before recently about the sound that you try to get in the orchestra, because I know that projecting is not going to be a big issue in that hall. Can you talk about a little bit about the energy that it takes, or that maybe you don't have to put out as much, and how that affects the way you approach playing in that particular orchestra?
Yes, this is a general concept I always had a bit with the trumpet playing. I was never a big fan of projection idea, like that you have to go through or you have to cut. And I always imagine myself being in the middle of my sound, and instead of power, I always imagine energy. So that you spread your energy everywhere. So it's more about filling the place than not actually going through something. So it's more, the concept is more to have a sound that embrace the people that are the listeners instead of beating the face of the listeners. That's a bit more, and I have to say, is a bit more, is also like kind of a concept that all the brass, like the colleagues, that we have in general here, you know, this kind of way of playing is more like, it's never aggressive. You know, we try to never be aggressive, you know, sometimes it's necessary, of course, but generally.
But not as, Well, I was speaking of your colleagues. It always appears, at least from the outside, that you all get along quite well. I know you're very close to Miro. We can talk about that a little bit too. But maybe speak about Miro and how you guys divide your duties as principal trumpets, and also about the collegiality that you have in the RCO brass ensemble and how that works. But just talk about those couple of things a little bit.
No, I mean, of course, with Miro, we are more than colleagues. We are like brothers. So it's just a privilege to have this situation, daily, you know, to work and to share also the job. And we are a friend. We are a group of friends, actually, which we're really close. It's with him, with Giuliano, with Philip Hutter, which is a principal trumpet in KKL and Lucerne. But of course with Miro we share this daily routine, and this very special. So we practice together, we just play together, we have fun together, and this is a way to for both of us to improve and to grow and to exchange ideas. To it's just beautiful to have somebody that you can trust, you know, and you can ask anything and you can just talk about whatever, you know. That's a special situation. And regarding the brass, is also a very special situation, because we are a group of people that really respect each other, that we have a huge respect for each other. So that's one of the reasons why we can actually work without conductors, or without having somebody that has to tell you what you have to do, but we can do it ourselves, because nobody really gets offended if you suggest something or you just say your opinion or whatsoever. And this makes this situation very special. Also the quality of players that you have in the orchestra, so that everybody is they're really, I mean, extraordinary individual players. And then when you put this individual quality together, then it becomes like something unique. And this is easier in a way to have a group outside of the orchestra, because you can pick the people, of course, so you can select the persons and the musicians that you like it. But in the orchestra, it's quite special to have this kind of energy and this kind of great, so many great musicians all together, you know.
Yeah. Absolutely. And I'm sure it helps. Obviously, the job can be quite stressful sometimes when you have big weeks coming up, and to have the kind of support from your colleagues is a huge thing. What are some ways you deal with stressful weeks? Because we'll talk about that as you have some big programs coming up. How do you mentally prepare for some of the concerts that you have to play, especially knowing that so many of them are broadcast worldwide like they are?
Yeah, one of the things I do is when I try to do this is to listen to the old recordings of the orchestra, and also compare to other recordings from other orchestra. That's, of course, one of the things I do, especially when I have a piece that I didn't play before. And then going through this, it's like preparation. You know, many, many pieces require different kind of preparation, also technical, as you know, you're also a great trumpet player. So It's a different kind of, like, if you have to work, like, for example, per Petrushka or this kind of more solistic pieces, you work more in flexibility, articulation, etc., etc. If you have to prepare Bruckner or kind of heavy stuff, then you work a bit more in the resistance, in the sound, you know, so you work more in the, like, practice more chorals, etc., etc. So it depends a bit, like, yeah, what you have to do. But basically now we also play quite few contemporary programs with like a new, we have a series that about contemporary music, you know, in Concertgebouw. So many new pieces and many new compositions comes up, you know, and then yeah, you just have to put there with a, you know, pencil and sous-vide and solfège and sing, you know. And the first thing, what I always tell to my students is that if you cannot sing something, you cannot play it. So I work a lot in the singing and with imagination also. That's what I do a lot also myself when I study.
I was gonna ask you about the solfege in we're talking about practicing a little bit. Of course, I think most people really associate the Concertgebouw a lot with quite a bit of Mahler's works. The orchestra obviously plays Mahler very, very well. When you became a member of the orchestra, were there composers that you were also like, this orchestra, the orchestra plays everything well. But what are the other strengths of the orchestra that people on the outside might not realize unless they're in the group? Are there composers or pieces that you think the group plays better than maybe some other orchestras outside of Mahler?
You know, this orchestra has a huge history, as you know. But for example, like Heldenleben, so from Strauss, this piece has been composed for Concertgebouw. He was this has been composed for Concertgebouw, has been premiered from Concertgebouw with Strauss conducting. And the funny thing is that the first there are images for that, and the trumpet players were playing American piston trumpet, were not German. So that's also funny. And this is the reason why we do play with American. Heldenleben is was not it was performed and premiered here with him, and it was with piston trumpet, not a German
With
trumpet.
this.
So it's a curiosity, but it's I mean. And of course, then the relationship between Mahler and the orchestra is very deep because Mengelberg, of course, and they were big friends itself. So many things has been premiered, or they being not the premiere because it was Mahler used to do the first premiere maybe in a small place and then coming to a big place, like for example what happened with Mahler 3, etc. But the second exhibition, the second performance of Mahler 3 was in Concertgebouw. And there are manuscripts of him, for example, regarding Posthorn, this kind of manuscript, which is there is also Posthorn, which is actually written from him, Flugelhorn, and or like other instruments. So yeah, Bruckner, of course, the connection with Bruckner and this orchestra is immense. But Wagner also, I mean.
So you could go on with that orchestra. I know it's kind of maybe it's not the best question because the answer is probably everything. And I think many people have seen the video that you did, which is really great. Speaking of Mahler, about the Posthorn solo, which is, if anybody hasn't seen it, it's on YouTube. It's fantastic.
Thank you.
Like many principal trumpets, I'm sure you've had, because you have to so many offstage things, Beethoven, Mahler, Respighi, etc. And I'm sure as you guys often tour quite a bit too, and play some of these pieces occasionally. Have you ever had any funny stories or anything strange happen backstage while you're waiting to play any of those particular pieces? Everybody seems to have a couple of stories like that.
Well, I mean, last time I was playing Mahler 3, there was a guy from the bar that he was opening the door just when I had to start, and he was carrying all the, you know, full, like his thing full of beers and wines, preparing for the end. And then he says, yeah, I have to play. I said, oh, sorry. And yeah, many things. But once also, I actually was with Seoul Philharmonic once, and I had to play this unanswered question, and I had a track in my headphone because I was totally away, far away, and so I could not see the conductor, etc. And then, of course, there was a battery, but of course, the battery went off exactly just a bit before. So this was quite fun, and I just played, and I hope somebody followed me. So yeah, some things like that, and there are some stories in Concertgebouw that, like, some years ago, this was not me, I was not there, there was a guy, he was late. So he came with a motorcycle, and he entered just on time to play his solo. And then he didn't even take the helmet out, but he just pulled up the helmet, and then he just played, you know, because he was just on time, you know.
That was not Fritz. I don't think that was Fritz.
No, it was not Fritz. It was not Fritz, no.
Wow.
No.
And obviously, the other side of that coin is, I'm sure every week in that orchestra can be really special for one reason or another. Are there any concerts that you've played so far that really stand out in your mind as, like, it really doesn't get any better than this? This is why you want to do this.
Well, there are some special moments. Like we did with Janssen's a special concert in St. Petersburg with Mahler II, and of course the father used to conduct in St. Petersburg, where he also, you know, and he studied there and he grew up. Also, he also conduct there, and you could see that was we did Mahler II there, I remember, and this was a special moment for him also, and was special energy as well in Moscow in the concert hall from the conservatory, which we did Heldenleben, was also fantastic. But for myself personally, it was very special when I played Mahler 5 in the Carnegie Hall with Bichkov some years ago. That was really, was a special day for me, special evening. And many, many things, like also like Shostakovich with Janssen and Zsuzsa, or Bruckner with Haitink, like fantastic. Mm. And then there is a beautiful recording of Bruckner with, oh geez, now I forgot them. Now I forgot, but yeah, I mean, there are many, many special moments, you know. Also some concerts with Gergiev were really, really special. And yeah, but also now with a new guy, you know, with this new Klaus Mäkelä, with a new conductor, also like there is a special connection with the orchestra somehow, you know.
Yeah, you're not the only principal trumpet to say that. I've heard quite a bit about him because he was just here in Chicago, and he's been in Cleveland recently too. So everybody seems to love him. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, he's a fantastic guy, you know, very, very nice guy. Great musician, of course, but also nice person.
Yeah. Yeah. It's an uncommon combination sometimes. But what, talk about the last Concertgebouw question I have is, you guys do tour quite a bit. And just as a point of practicality, when you practice on tour, are you the person that practices in the hotel room or with a practice mute, or do you get to the hall really early, or do you try to find a big room in a hotel? What is your kind of normal procedure?
All the things you mentioned.
Yeah.
I do. Yeah. I mean, the first thing I try to do is to find the big room in the hotel. If there is not, I practice in my room, which after 1 hour, most of the time they come to knock. and then I use a practice mute, and when it's possible to go early in the theater, I go. But sometimes, of course, you know, like you cannot enter much earlier, so that's a bit tricky. So I just practice with a mute, and then sometimes taking out for 5 minutes, then back again out for, and then, you know, just try to bother as less as possible. But yes, of course, I practice. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, so I want to talk about practicing a little bit more. So you mentioned the Louis Davidson book. Can you kind of describe the daily routine that you have, and what are the key things that you feel like you need to address in your playing on a regular kind of workday?
But generally, I make sure that all my basics are fine. So I'm not this kind of person that practice for hours one piece. Mm-hmm. You know, I practice hours basics, actually. So flexibility, articulations, like all the basics, you know, like whatever you want to mention, you know, it's not important what you do, but, you know. And then, of course, I do Davidson, I do Arban, I do Koprash, I do many books, but I make sure that my basics works. And then, of course, when I have to, then I practice my orchestra or things when I have to do, you know, like programs, etc. Or now, like for a few months now, I'm practicing this concerto from Morricone because it's very demanding. And then I invest like a few hours of from that. But I always make sure that I finish. I start with basics and I finish with basics.
Okay.
So even after I practice a piece, I always go back to my basics.
You kind of warm down, or just kind of more fundamentals in the end?
Yes, fundamentals, articulation, like to find again the right center, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah. Do you record yourself practicing?
Sorry, I didn't hear that.
I'm sorry. Are you someone that records? Do you record your practicing and listen back a lot?
Yeah, well, to be honest, not so much, because I don't like to listen to myself. So most of the time I don't like what I listen, but but I do when I want to punish myself, I record myself. Yes.
Well, speaking of punishing yourself, I know you have some thoughts about the right acoustic to practice in. So yes. Some people really like live rooms, some really like the kind of really dry rooms. What is your feeling on that?
Where I can, I practice in the boomy places when I can. Unfortunately, it's not so easy to find them, especially in the big cities. But I'm a big fan of boomy and church acoustics. For one reason, because you don't need to record yourself, but you can listen immediately what is happening. And it's like having a recorder on all the time and listening back directly, like constantly, you know. So you can immediately judge the quality of the sound. You can immediately judge the intonation. You can immediately judge the articulation, et cetera, et cetera. So, for example, when I was in Rome, I was lucky enough to have some spaces where was, I could practice, and they were boomy, and I was there, the whole day.
And also with practice, how do you vary your instruments? I mean, do you warm up on B flat trumpet, switch to C trumpet, or do you play C trumpet most of the time?
Yeah, I do both. I do both. I switch both.
Yeah.
And I used to play a bit of piccolo like regularly, not every day maybe, but even I don't have to play it, like every 2-3 days I play a bit of piccolo. Or sometimes I just like to play some things with flugelhorn because I like the sound. And it's more like having fun for a kid, you know, like just Whenever you feel like you just take a toy and you play with it, you know.
And you did mention practicing solfege during your practice. Is that like a regular thing that you do kind of daily? Is it part of your regimen and or when you're working on new pieces?
Yes, definitely. That's the first thing I do. Yeah.
That's the first thing you do.
Yeah, to make sure to
you mean
know
every day.
No, well, if I already did, I mean, if I know the piece, I already did once and it's clear in my head, then of course I don't do it every day. But if there is a passage or whatsoever doesn't come, I sing it most of the time. So I make sure that the pitch, you know, the intervals and everything is clear in my head, it's clear in my mind, you know, like that I know where I have to go. That's very important for me.
The last thing I wanted to touch on is a couple things. And we brought it up before. Chamber music is obviously very important to you. And you and Giuliano founded Italian Wonder Brass. How often does that quintet get together with the busy schedules that you guys have?
Well, unfortunately, now not so often. And it was like before the pandemic times that we met, unfortunately. And yeah, it's not so easy, but it's still alive in our hearts. And we will we are planning to do something in the next year, like to go to Taiwan or to do some tours and to play some concerts. But now it's not so easy. And of course, it's in a way easier to organize chamber music here in Amsterdam. So we have a brass quintet with the orchestra, like with Miro and the other principals, and also the tentet now. So we do quite a lot of activities here now.
And of course, millions of people have watched on YouTube some of the RCO brass videos. So finally, the next question I want to ask you is, well, the next two questions about your recording, Entrada, which is a fantastic recording. If anybody doesn't know it, I'll put a link up here so they can find it. And what I really like is this mix of Russian and you have a kind of a Russian and French mix, which I think are probably the two most important schools of trumpet playing. It has, if anybody doesn't know, it has Brandt, Glazunov, the Dachshitzer's arrangement of Gershwin, so that's still Russian, then Onegur, Enesco, and Francais. And then also, is it Gorgis? Am I pronouncing the correctly? The piece for saxophone and trumpet. So is that a new composition that was written for you? Is that a new piece?
Yeah, this is a piece. It's from Rob Corrales, which is an organ player, Dutch organ player. I wanted to, my partner, she's the saxophonist, Femke Elstra, and she's also the saxophone player of the orchestra. And we wanted to record something together, but I really didn't find something very interesting for the formation for trumpet and saxophone, which I have to say, to be honest, I also played a few things with a saxophone quartet some years ago. It's a fantastic match. It sounds really beautiful, you know?
Yeah.
These instruments really match beautiful together, like very, very nicely. And then we didn't find anything really like, and so we said, okay, why don't we actually ask a great composer to write something for us? And it was also an opportunity to bring a new piece in the repertoire, and so why not? And I'm quite happy that actually we did, because I like that piece very, very much. I think it's very interesting for all the instruments involved, even for the piano also. There is a very beautiful lento, and so it's very, very interesting. And it's nice. It's a nice piece. It's not too difficult. So even like a good student can do it. So it's playable. It's not this kind of crazy things, that impossible stuff, you know. So
right.
it's something that, if somebody wants to do something with a saxophone, they can try to do it, and if they like it. So
yeah,
I thought it was interesting thing to do.
Yeah, and it makes sense in the album because you have such a great contrast between the Russian and the French, and then the saxophone piece in the middle of it. So it's a nice contrast. And clearly, you listened to quite a bit of Dachshitzer growing up. That's really very evident on the recording. So, and the last thing I wanted to mention is, of course, the piece you're playing next week. If you could talk about this concerto, the Morricone concerto, because like you said, most people don't know this piece. And I think a lot of us know a lot of his movie music, but not this concerto. It's very not played as much.
No, it's not, and this is one of the reasons why I wanted to do, because this concerto, which is the title of the concerto is Ut, which means like Do, like C, this concerto has been composed in 1991, 1992 was out, but it was the age of experimental music, not just before the electronic things really entered, of course, you know, like Varese was using, etc., but there was this kind of search and experimental things, and it is a very interesting concerto. It's for a string orchestra, timpani and gran cassa, and of course a trumpet solo. And it's funny enough, but many, many trumpet players don't know that this piece exists. And of course, Ennio Morricone is one of the greatest composer of, the past 50 years, etc. He's known for his amazing film music, of course, but this concerto, I think, deserve attention and deserve to be, to be listened, and to maybe to somebody also that wants to practice and perform it. You know, it's gonna be the Netherlands premiere. You know, after 31 years, it's gonna be the Netherlands premiere. And wow. I think it can be actually a worldwide premiere, because I don't know anybody that ever played this outside of Italy. So I'm not sure that somebody ever performed this in the United States either. So
never heard of it here.
But we have in our repertoire, we have Ennio Morricone trumpet concerto. You know, if we would have John Williams trumpet concerto, I'm pretty sure many people would have played and performed, you know.
Oh, so, we do have a John Williams trumpet concerto. It's just really hard.
Yes. Yes, exactly. Exactly. Exactly.
Is this recording, is it going to be recorded, this piece?
Yes, we are going to do recording. Like, it's going to be a CD in which I think it will appear as this contemporary music CD series, which we do live as a live RCO recordings. And I think there will be also Mezzo TV recording the CD. So it's also going to be on TV. Yeah.
Fantastic. Fantastic.
Stressful.
Just like this interview was very stressful, right? You're really nervous about it. Well, Omar, thank you so much. I'll stop the recording in just a second, but I wanted to thank you again, and I'm sure everybody will enjoy hearing what you have to say. And we always look forward to hearing you on YouTube and on the new recording, which I'll post a link to. And good luck on the upcoming concerto.
Thank you very much, and all the best to you and to everybody that is listening.
Thank you.